Welcome to the Investing with IBD podcast, sponsored by Vantage Point. It's Wednesday, September 15th, 2021, and I'm Justin Nielsen, your host. And of course, as always, every week joining me is Arusha Paris from O'Neill Global Advisors, portfolio manager there, the other part of this dynamic duo. Welcome again, Arusha. Thanks for coming on.
Hey, it's always great to be here, Justin.
And as a special treat, we have one of the former colleagues at William O'Neill and Company, Mary Ellen McGonagle. Now, Mary Ellen is a president at MEM Investment Research and also the senior managing director of stocks at Simpler Trading. So welcome to the show, Mary Ellen.
Oh, great. Thanks.
It's good to see you again. It's been about 10 years, I guess, since we've seen each other in person, something like that. But you you worked with William O'Neill and Company for 15 years. And of course, one of the things in your time there, being in institutional sales, you were going out talking to institutions and you were part of that weekly call of Bill O'Neill that was happening. So you got to hear a lot of lessons directly from him. So we're looking forward to you sharing some of those lessons with us and our listeners today.
Sounds great. Yeah, I look forward to it as well.
So we'll go ahead and start with, as always, a little bit of a look at the markets. Then we'll get into some of those lessons, again, that Mary Ellen has learned and this top-down approach that she takes, looking at the sectors, the industry groups, and then using that to kind of inform her decisions on stocks. And of course, we'll get some ideas from Mary Ellen on stocks themselves, particularly what industry groups she sees coming up now. So let's go ahead and get to it. Mary Ellen, we really have been kind of pulling back a little bit in this market, and it's been interesting because it just seems like it's a buy on the dip mentality, and that the market will never go down again. That's what people are thinking, but you were there at William O'Neill and Company back in the late 90s and 2000 when that buy on the dip mentality kind of it worked until it didn't, right?
It evaporated absolutely at one point. And as a matter of fact, Bill, while there, I can recall in 99 in particular, one of the more animated meetings, it just really struck me. And Bill informed us, there were about 12 of us in the room, and he said, what you're experiencing right now in 99 is historical. You're not going to see this again in your lifetime. And boy, was he right there. Yeah, it was amazing. And certainly during that period, you could buy in the dip, but not into the first quarter of 2000.
Right. Just a few months later, and that could have been a recipe for disaster. So here's a chart of the NASDAQ, the S&P 500 index. And again, what we've seen here is this has hardly had more than a 5% correction at any one point. And here we are again, seems like today, getting support at the 50-day moving average line, a nice bounce today. Do you think this is another opportunity?
I do, yes. I have a weekly newsletter, and it's the MEM Edge report. And in that report, I did suggest that you could buy on the dip. The growth prospects, the backdrop is still very, very strong. And so on these kinds of pullbacks, and we've certainly seen at least seven this year, and those pullbacks really, again, that economic, particularly after second quarter earnings have been released, the backdrop is super strong. So to see anything more than a typical pullback, I think we would need to see something very substantial in the way of greatly reduced GDP outlook or other growth prospects. Mm-hmm.
And with all of the Fed taper talk, it seems like that's one of those wall of worry type things that the market is climbing right now. I mean, there's also some weak data out of China. So I guess, you mentioned some of the economic factors that you're looking at. Is there anything on the chart you feel that could give you an edge in terms of telling you, hey, this might be a bounce that doesn't work? What is it that you're looking for maybe on the chart?
This will ring true to you, I'm sure. But anytime we see a break below that key 50-day simple moving average, that's when that yellow flag is going to turn a little red. And that is always the line in the sand, of course, for both the broader markets and for individual stocks.
Mm-hmm. And what about you, Arusha? How have you been kind of handling this this market? Are you getting a little bit more aggressive now? Or did you stay aggressive and just said, hey, I'm going to hold through this pullback?
No, I didn't stay aggressive. When the market was moving up, I try to make more of a conscious effort to lighten up on some of my stocks and sell into strength. Because I've never really been great at that. So I was like, let me force myself to lighten up a little bit, take something off the table. And so today, by the end of the day, I started to add back some to it, to positions, added some new stocks that are starting to form the right-hand sides of bases or have pulled back to key support areas, kind of like the S&P is doing here. So I agree with both of you. This is, as long as this character stays intact, and this has been going on for a long time now, it's over a year, really. I mean, we only really broke the 50-day back at the beginning of March.
Yeah, for a day.
For a day, exactly. And then we came back pretty quickly. But as long as that's there, you have to assume that the character is intact until you see a true character change. Let me just quickly switch over to the NASDAQ.
I was just going to say, let's take a look at the NASDAQ because, this had a little bit more of a struggle around the 50-day moving average line around that March period. There was a lot of kind of, maybe a correction through time, a little bit more substantial of a correction there, whereas the S&P 500 hasn't done much more than 5%. This was approaching 10% on the NASDAQ at one point, from that first drop in mid-February to the March low, it was probably about 8% or so. Does that kind of inform your decisions at all in terms of where you're putting your money, Mary Ellen?
Oh, absolutely. We had some tough goes there with the NASDAQ in that March period. A lot of that was the FANG, the mega cap stocks. And then into May, it was higher interest rate, inflation fears. So yes, there was definite difficult periods there with rotation around software to name one industry grouping. But more recently, if you look at the NASDAQ, it's really holding in remarkably well. And I would argue it is beyond the mega cap FANG stocks that we are seeing great strength in other areas as well.
And do you look at the breadth at all, like an advanced decline line?
I don't look at that. I mean, I look at it more from a bigger picture, but I know that you probably have some accumulation distribution, maybe metrics that you would use, but breadth is actually bigger picture. You, of course, want to see all and more industry groups participating as a way to keep and continue to buoy the markets. So I look at breadth from that regard.
And so when you look at breadth from that regard, it still is pretty narrow. I mean, maybe it's starting to broaden out a little bit, but that's really been one of the concerns over the last few months, especially. It just seemed like all the money was going towards the mega caps, the tech stocks. And meanwhile, underneath the surface, there are a lot of other stocks in the mid caps or small caps that were getting hit and plenty of stocks falling below their 200-day moving average.
That's true. Yeah, small caps have struggled, no doubt about it, by and large. So
and I can go ahead and show the IWM here, which is the iShares Russell 2000 ETF, which did cross below the 200-day moving the 50-day moving average line yesterday and got back above it today. It's been getting support at the 200-day moving average line. So do you feel like small caps are participating again, or are they still a little bit on the ropes?
Yeah, they're all about that recovery play. So today we did see industrials and materials, and a lot of those recovery type areas coming back into vogue, if you will, not in a tremendous way. So that small cap arena is going to be in line with that. So if we get more of a sense of an economic, as far as expansion continuing, ideally, we would like to see small caps, of course.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the things I've struggled with personally is that it seems like some of these rotations, you mentioned how there was strength today in the materials, a lot of the steel stocks, oil was doing well, industrials, financials even were participating. Those were some of the bigger gaining sectors today. But it seems like the favoritism can just change day to day. And how has that I guess, maybe changed your outlook or the way you approach things when sometimes it feels hard to get much of a long-term trend in something. It feels like there's these shorter trends that are happening, bubbling underneath the surface, I guess.
I did get into bank stocks in particular last fall, back in November 15th, arena, mm-hmm. October 22nd, and then at it. So I was able to participate at that time, but then exited those stocks in May as they began to break down. And when that sector group breaks down, that break below the 50-day into June, got rid of all of the bank stocks, and then only recently have very selectively gotten in, not so much banks, but more into the Goldman Sachs, those right. financials that are more diversified and not regional banking per se. But overall, I'm not going to play those moves back in unless I see more, as you were saying earlier, more participation. So that's what I'm going to be on the lookout for. And energy is looking tremendous, by the way.
Yeah.
About recovery. I did put one stock on a couple of weeks ago, but to any of my subscribers out there, I'm going to be adding three more today.
Okay. So a little projection there for folks. And we're going to be dropping this tomorrow. So they check their emails on that. Well, when we get back, we'll go ahead and talk about some of the ways in which you were able to identify the sectors that were looking the best months ago. And of course, we'll look at more of these sectors that you're seeing appear on your screens right now. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Kicking yourself for that early exit? You can prevent them, and it's easier than you think. Go to freestockcoaching.com to see the tool independent traders are using to perfect their trades, artificial intelligence. AI doesn't involve staring at your screen for hours, and no research is needed. Just pick a stock and press a button. Visit freestockcoaching.com to see a live demo now. You need to be ready for rapid market changes, and AI can help you avoid potential losses. Check out freestockcoaching.com to learn more. Trading involves financial risk and is not suitable for all investors. Past results do not guarantee future performance.
Welcome back to the Investing with IBD podcast, sponsored by Vantage Point. It's Justin Nielsen here, along with Arusha Paris and our guest, Mary Ellen McGonagle. Mary Ellen is someone that you can find on Twitter at MEM Investments, if you'd like to kind of connect with her, if you like some of the stuff that you're hearing from her on today's show. But Mary Ellen, again, thanks for coming on the show. And let's get into it. Let's talk a little bit about your approach. We've been talking with some people on the show here lately that have been doing more of a bottom-up approach. They look at the stocks and that kind of informs them of what industries to look at and what they think of as the health in the market. But you take a different approach. You take a top-down approach. Can you describe that a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely. So my approach at the very beginning of my research process is to take a look at those 11 sectors in the broader markets. I want to see where the relative strength, where the relative outperformance is. That's where I want to be fishing, if you will. And mm-hmm. then, of course, the health. Take a look at those charts. Are they advancing, forming the right side of bases, proceeding higher, or otherwise? So from there, then I very quickly can assess those sub-industry groupings. MarketSmith is a great tool for that, where you can not only say, gee, retail's kind of faltering, you can really zone in precisely where. So from there, I will then go and uncover stocks, those that have those high growth prospects, that are in demand, that are rising on volume. So
Well, can you maybe give us an example with how you maybe use this in the last year?
Oh, sure. Absolutely. It's always been an integral part of my work. So in the very beginning of the year, there was this period of continued uncertainty so that the broader markets were struggling overall. Yet there was a carryover of energy and financial stocks into March. Mm-hmm. So that led me to stay with those bank stocks, with those energy stocks that I had picked up back October and November of 2020. So that was the real growth to my portfolio, to my list, and then sprinkled in there were other groupings as they came into favor. So for the most part, the beginning of the year was a continuation rally of those recovery areas. And then as we proceeded, I think I provided a bar chart from March on. You can see now that first chart is the beginning of the year, and you can see energy and financials very clear-cut outperformers. So that those charts that looking at the relative strength guided me to stay with those stocks. And then as the year progressed, as we got into March and beyond, we did see other areas come into play. I think there's another bar chart there. And yeah, so in fact, technology and healthcare, and this had a lot to do with those companies starting to come in with Q1 numbers within healthcare, a lot of medical products. So again, being able to uncover those sectors that are exhibiting strength and money flows, and then from there, pick the top candidates.
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because, you know, as you were saying, the energy, the industrials, some of those that were the biggest winners, those became the biggest losers, right? So energy was down, you know, of course, again, part of that rotation. But let's back up a little bit here, though. You were kind of sharing how you were adding to some of these areas at the beginning of the year in January of 2021. But how was it that you started picking them up in October and November? I mean, it certainly, that was an area where I felt like, at least, you know, in September, you know, we had come up so much in 2020. We took that break in September. And then, you know, we were going sideways for a while. And the question was, okay, is that it? You know, or are some of these technology stocks going to continue? What kind of led you to, hey, I'm seeing something happening in energy, and I'm seeing something happening in the financials?
Oh my gosh, great question. The number one driver, what was beginning to occur, where these companies were coming in ahead of estimates, ahead of earnings, as very depressed estimates, and other factors that were coming into play as well after Pfizer was pre-approved or emergency approved for the vaccine.
Vaccine day, November 9th.
Yep. Oh my gosh. So we did see an outflow out of bonds into stocks. So interest rates started to rise. And then also going into the pandemic, there were mandates for these banks to be very fully capitalized. There was no idea of how this might end. So the banks were fully capitalized. Also, in their earnings reports in that November period, they were saying that their default rates were lower, were going down, and their outlook, the management for these bank stocks, FITB is a good example.
Fifth Third Bancor.
Yeah, they came out with numbers. They were 35% ahead of estimates, and 30% ahead of estimates around November 15th. They came out with super good numbers, were guiding higher going into next year. And then, of course, for me, I needed to see that financial sector, XLF, turn positive, or else I would not be convinced that this move was real. So we did get that gap up following the Pfizer news that was confirmation. So from there, I added SIVB, SVB Corp. Yeah. An RF and probably about four or five names that did go on to super great heights into June before removing them. But again, that earnings, those earnings reports were the biggest driver. Likewise with energy, and also each of these industry groups were the worst performers going into Q4 last year. I believe bank stocks were down 27%, just a huge number. The outlooks were dismal. So they were very ripe for the picking, if you will. So energy stocks, same thing, where they started coming in with really good numbers. DVN was one of the first names I picked up back there. It did go on to gain 128% before we took it off the list. But that same phenom where it had that move up in response to earnings, and then XLE, the industry group, was confirming a move. And then, of course, you like to see that increased volume during that October, November period back there that is confirming that downtrend reversal if you move over to November.
So $17.8 million on Devon Energy right there. Yeah.
So this is where on November 9th is where you were adding Devon Energy as it was gapping up here?
Or
did you wait a little bit later until it got past 1325? Kind of like almost like a double bottom-ish kind of thing.
I did wait. Yeah. Actually, okay. It was later. It was around November 16th that was added. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. So that you're getting over. So you waited for, you started seeing confirmation in the sector, but mm-hmm. you're still letting each individual stock. You want them to get over some kind of resistance, establish a little bit of an uptrend at least before adding it to the list.
Right, and then coming in with numbers that were well ahead of estimates and promising outlook.
Yeah. Now let's talk a little bit about these numbers because, some folks might be listening to this and they're like, wait a minute, this, Mary Ellen was listening to Bill O'Neill for 15 years and was buying things that didn't have, earnings or didn't have great earnings. How does that fit in CanSlim? So what was it that you learned from Bill that kind of allowed you to project what was happening a little bit with the earnings before it became, I guess, more obvious?
That is such a great question. And I would tell you that it has a lot to do with my background as far as working with these institutional mm-hmm. money managers, all about looking out 2 months, being proactive, not waiting for that print. And again, using the charts in conjunction with that. And on the institutional side, we did have I believe it's still there, a very, very premier institutional idea product, and mm-hmm. it was not unheard of to have energy stocks in there, materials stocks. So it was an area that I was not afraid to wade into, knowing the potential upside once they got going.
And you saw Bill do it a few times.
I did. That helped.
Yeah. I think I remember, what was it, in like 2005 or 2004, something like that, where he was buying Valero, VLO, and these oil stocks. And I'm
absolutely
like, what? PPR. This isn't CanSlim. And even in 2008, he was all over, Continental Resources, CLR in March. And, it's certainly... it was one of those things where he would always go where the strength was. And
go a little bit more into that, Justin, where and Mary Ellen, where what was Bill saying at that point, saying, okay, this is why we're going into these commodity type of stocks that are, they're not the traditional CanSlim.
Well, if you look at some of these, maybe I guess a weekly wouldn't do it, but they actually were coming in. There were periods where the numbers were real. They were coming in mm-hmm. very good. I can go back and think about the drillers and different areas. So despite that they are not that pure growth play, they were coming in with very substantial numbers. The growth was there.
Yeah. And he was still using chart patterns and things like that as a reason to get into. You still managing his risk if it went against him and all that stuff, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah.
And there was also the economic thesis, right? At that time, you had, China and India, there was a lot of infrastructure that was going on. You had, I remember a lot of the steel stocks back then, Schnitzer Steel and titanium, there was an aluminum company of China.
ACH.
ACH. Yeah. And so, Mary Ellen's like, oh, there memories,
There you go. You hear it's ACH.
Yeah.
That's
so
awesome. Yeah.
I remember that again, during this time period, it was, that's what was working at the time. And again, there was an economic thesis behind it. So back to your kind of top-down mm-hmm. approach, you identified, hey, there were some sectors that were moving, that were showing strength. And then it was just a matter of drilling down to those individual stocks to find out, who are the true leaders here?
And we can't ignore the price of oil. So what happened in last fall, it was at about $45, but akin to where $70 per barrel for Brent is the benchmark now. 50 was that big, if we can only get to 50. And we did. We got to 50 at the end of last year, which then propelled that group into the new year.
Sometimes those psychological numbers make a big difference, huh?
Yeah. And one other key thing is that even as Bill says in the book, 25% of the companies are going to be turned around, or those are just going to be the stocks that are in favor.
Yeah, the model book, you know, right. Referring to the model book stocks.
Exactly. Yes,
those
yes,
are the
yes,
ones
yes.
that are these, you know, big leaders, you know, because again, he's gone back 100 years, you know, for the leaders of each market cycle. And yeah, sometimes they're the turnarounds.
That's it. And this year in particular, we haven't always been paid to chase, if you will, or you're never paid to chase, but base breakouts have not always worked. So turnaround has been one area, even outside of these recovery stocks.
Yeah. And since we've been pulling up a lot of MarketSmith charts, I do want to let folks know, hey, you know, we've been having free access week on MarketSmith. And that's one thing that, you know, you still have a little bit of time to take advantage of that free access after this podcast drops. Your time is going to be running out. But Arusha, where can people go to get that information? On the free
access. You could go to marketsmith.com and there'll be some information there, or even investors.com. There'll be some links for MarketSmith free access. And you'll have, since you're listening to this on Thursday, you'll have Friday and Saturday to be able to check it out. And I think you just have to enter your email address and then you get a chance to open up the charts and take a little spin on IBD's premier product.
Yeah. And of course, you know, having Saturday, a lot of people talk about their weekend routine.
Yeah.
Mary Ellen, could you maybe share with us what your weekend routine is like? What is it that you do on the weekends to kind of prepare for the next week?
Great question. I can think back, Mike Rinaldi, you would plop a big box outside of my door for 15
right.
years every Saturday.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And
two big
goodness.
Books, right? You know, probably two big books and some data monitors if I'm...
You're absolutely right. There were about 10 or 15,000 charts and I would just... people would be watching football. I'd just be going through the charts.
Just
but
page
now,
after page.
I do put my newsletter out on Sunday. So my weekends and really probably every day with the markets. But as I go into the end of the week, I'm going to, again, start with those sectors, map out those FANG stocks. What are they up to? Those sub-industry groupings, software, biotech. Where are we? What did we see last week? And what's starting to perk up? But Saturday and Sunday is all about putting it all together.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we're going to listen to a little bit of what Mary Ellen has put together recently, what kind of top-down sector approach, what is she seeing now that can maybe help you for the next few weeks or months. So stay tuned for that.
Why trade off hope and optimism when you can trade using the world's most powerful indicator? Artificial intelligence has been used by traders to navigate the markets for the past three decades. Visit freestockcoaching.com to see the world-leading AI forecasting software for yourself. Trusted by more than 32,000 traders, AI uses millions of data points to track market trends, giving you the support you need right now. Go to freestockcoaching.com and we will help you find great opportunities today. Our experts will show you what stocks are setting up for big changes right now. So head over to freestockcoaching.com for a free demo. Trading involves financial risk and is not suitable for all investors. Past results do not guarantee future performance.
Welcome back to the Investing with IBD podcast, sponsored by Vantage Point. It's Justin Nielsen, Arusha Paris from O'Neill Global Advisors, and Mary Ellen McGonagle from MEM Investment Research. So, Mary Ellen, before we get into what's on your radar now, maybe we can talk a little bit about this shift where tech came back into favor. So, what was it that happened that allowed you to recognize that shift?
Yeah. So again, it's all about looking at those money flows. And so we did have that fallout with interest rates rising, inflation fears, but tech did come back. And it was probably in that April period when we started to see tech come back into play. So then from there, of course, you want to be able to identify the sub-industry groups so that you can participate. And I think I provided a chart that shows the S&P 500, and that's the green line. And then you can see the red line is the software ETF, and it's very clearly outperforming the S&P. Of course, technology and software in line. So from there, of course, you always want to then identify the top candidate, that leadership name. So from there, that top line is Adobe, ADBE is the ticker symbol. And that was one of the stocks that I put on our list April 9th. What you'll see is that the company, just before reporting earnings, it did come back into play. It moved back above resistance, and that's taking us to that actually June, you're absolutely right, June 9th. And so what we saw at that time was a base breakout. Take a look at that huge volume characteristic. And this was ahead of earnings. I very rarely put stocks on
going. I was just going to ask you about that. Like, you know, how scary is that when it happens right before earnings?
And I did in that, I did specify, hey, if you're going to get in, keep your position light if you're risk adverse, or wait until after the numbers, but this stock is ready to go. And so we can see that it had that base breakout 2 days later. It reported very stellar earnings, and it is still on our list, and it's due to report earnings next Tuesday, actually. And they got it. What happened today was a big Morgan Stanley price target upgrade. And when you see these analysts right before earnings putting in price target upgrades or general upgrades, they're not going to do that unless they have some sort of insight that you and I might not have, because really egg on the face next week if the company doesn't come in with good numbers. So I'd pay attention to that a lot as well.
That's interesting. A lot of times when I see analyst upgrades, I get, I'm kind of the other way. I get a little bit more suspicious of that. Well, if the stock's already taken off, now they're trying to catch up to it.
Right.
Because they're seeing the stock kind of run away. But sometimes, you know, I'll see analyst upgrades and it will create excitement. And then all of a sudden that's probably close to some kind of short-term top. And then the stock might take a little bit of a break.
And that's actually a very good point. If you look at the stocks that have gone on to greater heights after their earnings, it's going to be PANW. It's going to be those down and out names that surprised, that are really going to give you that extra oomph. So great. There it is. We're looking at PANW on the daily, and it broke below its 50-day just before.
Right.
Yeah. And some of these companies lately have been really, you know, coming out after their earnings. I mean, some really big moves. I mean, you're talking 15, 20% or more sometimes. Is that, when you see a move like that, is that something where, okay, the valuation is changing so much because of whatever they announced that you feel like you want to participate in that? Or is that something that you generally wait on?
No, so that's a great, so DKS is another stock from my MEM Edge report.
Dick Sporting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we had it on prior to their prior quarter earnings where they gapped up. Mm-hmm. And so subsequent to that big gap up, great numbers, management guiding well into next year higher. So from there, there was about a two-week period where I kept saying, you can buy it, it's going higher. And it was because I did something I would not do with institutions, but I drilled down to that intraday chart. And when you can, I know, a 60-minute chart and using a 5 and a 13-hour moving average. And I'm telling you, it is, I mean, Chipotle, all of those gaps up, it can really help you as guidance. Nike.
Yep.
Just get a little bit fine-tuned there. So enough of this past talk. Let's talk about the future. What is on your radar now? What are you looking at?
So yeah, within technology, I know it's been a little bit dicey, but if we could take a look at SOXX, that's the semiconductor broader index, and you'll see that it has been indecisive to say the least, but more recently firming up very nicely, poised to break out of a nice two-week base there, huge volume characteristics. KLAC had a nice base breakout. And again, those volume characteristics as it broke out are very constructive. Now, at this juncture, it certainly is extended. I would look for a pullback. When these stocks get going, I tend to put a 5-day moving average in, and that becomes a pullback to that becomes an ideal buy point, but that one certainly looks ready to take off. We can also take a look at a manufacturing stock, ON. I just recently added that one, and so that had that nice gap up last week, and we can see that it is poised to potentially trend higher. I'd like to see a little more volume on this upside, but the growth prospects for this year, 191% over last year, so you really can't argue with that. And then let's take a look at ASYS. Now, this is super small. It's $170 million company.
Okay.
But I just couldn't ignore it. Actually, I was looking at this today. Okay. Well, anyway, on Monday. So if we look at this, now the company did come out with news that they had in August, the month of August, they had record bookings for their products. So there is a driver there. They also came out with very good earnings, 400% year over year back at the end of July. But during that period, these equipment stocks were not in favor.
And both of these look like they were breaking out on Friday of last week. And this was not the best market. I mean, the market was pulling back, this whole time, and these stocks were just not. And Arusha was doing a great job for people that are watching the video. He was showing how the volume, especially on KLAC that we're seeing right now, just really ramping up in a big way above average volume as that buying came in.
And you're absolutely, obviously, spot on, because of course, when you see stocks that are bucking any overall downtrend, last Friday was a very tough day, but when you see these stocks powering to new highs on volume, you have to pay attention, because when they do come into favor, ASML has been another big winner for
it just keeps on going
for MEM Edge report. But it too is hitting a new high. Now they have a product that only they produce. It's based out of the Netherlands. So that gives them that really coveted ability to provide solely. So,
A moat, pricing power, you name it.
But again, that volume, last week on Friday.
Any other sectors that you're looking at? And again, this is a great one, especially because one of the other things that Arusha was doing here was he was pointing out the relative strength lines on a lot of these, and the relative strength lines, which is comparing that stock to the S&P 500. You're just seeing these really, going in a very strong trend up for a lot of. Is that something you pay a lot of attention to?
Sure, absolutely. That's going to be that relative outperformance that I mentioned that I want to see in that stock. And then, of course, that relative strength hitting a new high as the stock price does, confirming the that relative strength. And that's all going to be part of the puzzle, definitely. Another area we can take a quick look at if you want to pull up XLV is healthcare. Now, the overall chart is not going to look good. It's heavily weighted in pharma, and a lot of these big pharmas are suffering. But back taking a look, I talk about those sub-industry groups. If you pull up IHI, and that is a medical products, medical device ETF, and you can see that it has been a real relative outperformer, and it had that nice base breakout back there at the end of May, and it's all about earnings. A lot of it is people like to complicate investing. It can be simplified in the sense that a lot of these medical products are catering to an aging baby boomer, a lot of heart device. And then, of course, with COVID and diabetes, DXCM type of names that had a pullback this week, but are coming back on.
Yeah. And what was Tandem just got added to an index, I think. They jumped quite a
nice
bit.
Yep.
You're right. Yeah. So, I mean, between the diabetes, the heart issues, you've got a lot of these that are, and while we're on the topic, I mean, you were bringing up how EW was another one of your big winners.
Still have it on our list. This is a stock that came out with super Q1 earnings back in April, and we can see that it had a pretty big advance. So at that advance, we did put it on the watch list because it was stretched and waiting for that pullback. And it did, it pulled back to that 50-day. And then once it breaks back above those shorter term simple moving averages, the 21 and the 10-day, that is your key to get back in, because the numbers were really phenomenal. And then you had that volume on that pullback reversal. So,
Well, Mary Ellen, it was great talking to you again. You just gave a lot of great information. And hey, thank you for plugging MarketSmith too. So as a reminder for folks,
I'm not going to get a check for that.
Exactly. Yeah. Your check is in the mail.
it's not Arush, a very big check.
Yeah, Arush will drop that off. But it was really nice chatting with you again. And again,
likewise,
just as a reminder for folks that, we do have that free access for MarketSmith for a few more days here. So you can take advantage of that and certainly take a look at some of the webinars that we have so that you can, you know, learn about some of the things you can do on the platform, because it is very powerful in terms of screening and just pattern recognition, everything. So Arusha, did you have anything else that you wanted to say on that?
No, once again, you can just go to investors.com, marketsmith.com. There'll be information there how to sign up for the free access. It should be pretty quick and easy, and you'll have a few days to go and incorporate it into your routine. I think very, very quickly, the big things, get familiar with the charts. We've shown a number of charts here. And then just use the stock ideas button and maybe just use the first few lists. We have a breaking out today. We have a near pivot. I would just focus on those initially, just so you can get used to how powerful the platform is.
Yeah. So thanks for that. And again, Mary Ellen, thank you so much for being on. With your Twitter handle, that's again at MEM Investments. So for people that would like to connect with Mary Ellen and kind of get some of her insights, that's the place to do it. And that's it for our show this week. Thank you so much for joining us, and we hope you join us next week. Thanks a lot.
And for this week's notes and charts, make sure to go to investors.com/podcast, where you'll find details for each episode in the podcast episode section. And make sure to subscribe, rate, and review our podcast if you haven't already. We'd really appreciate it. You can also send us your questions and comments to investingpodcast@investors.com. We would love to hear from you and may use your comments on an upcoming episode.
Hey everyone, thanks so much for watching Investors Business Daily on YouTube. If you want to watch more videos, make sure you hit that subscribe button so you don't miss a thing.